All right, so this next one is kind of two tips in one, because I'm going to show you how you can extend what happens when learners drop an object on a correct or incorrect target. So we're going to look at animating those objects out as they're dropped on either target. But to do this, I'm going to have to show you a few things about the timeline and how to control those exit animations. So without further ado, let's go ahead and jump in and see how this all comes together. Okay, starting with a drag and drop interaction. I'm just going to preview this real quick so you can see how this is working. There's nothing really added to it. It's just a simple convert to freeform slide where we have these notes and we drop them onto one of the targets. Now I have enabled the drop correct and incorrect states, so we get that visual feedback. We can choose to keep that or not. But what I want to do is I want to animate the cards as they're dropped out. I want to have an exit animation applied so they kind of spin or fade or scrunch or do, you know, shrink, do something like that. So we can do that by selecting the graphics. I could select all of them if I want to play this all at once, which is super fast. Then head on up here to the ribbon, and under the animations tab, I don't want an entrance animation. I mean, I guess I could, right? That's easy to do. But what I want to do is work with an exit animation. So let's do the spin and shrink, I think is nice. And shrink and turn, yeah, spin and shrink. So it'll kind of like spin and get smaller as it's dropped on each target. So that's what I want to have happen. Now, the way this works though, the way exit animations work is they're fired based on the timeline, right? So an entrance animation is going to apply as soon as the slide loads, the timeline begins, and the exit is going to kick in right here at the end. So if I were to leave this as it is, then after 5 seconds, or really I guess 4 seconds, it'll last 4 seconds, these are all going to fade out and or spin out because the timeline's going to end, right? So if I preview it, that's not what we want. We obviously want the animation to hold, right? To pause that animation and only trigger that animation when the objects are dropped on a target. So after 5 seconds, there they go. That's not what we want. So what we need to do is something really simple. We just need to pause the timeline. So you need to pause the timeline anytime before those exit animations kick in. So I can come to 3 seconds right here. And if that's where I want to pause, I have a couple options. I can add a trigger to say pause timeline when it reaches 3 seconds, or I can add what's called a cue point. Now the cue points, I think, are a little bit more flexible in a lot of cases, because you can tie the trigger to the cue point, and then you can move the cue point around the timeline if you need to fine tune it. It's a little bit easier than having to change the time code. So what I'll do is I'm just going to put my cursor playhead right here at the 3 second mark, and then I'm going to press the C. C as in Charlie on the keyboard. And so you can see right there, I've added a cue point, and I can move it around if I felt like I needed some more fine tuning. So what I'll do is we'll add a trigger, a timeline trigger that pauses our timeline when the timeline reaches that cue point. And that'll prevent the timeline from reaching the end and firing those exit animations. So we just add a trigger over here in the triggers panel. What is it I want to do? I want to pause the timeline. So down here under pause timeline, we'll just pause it. And we'll say pause the timeline on the slide when the timeline reaches. So it's a timeline event. So down here at the very bottom, we'll say timeline event reaches, and then we say cue point. So the benefit right here is you can see the time is 2.64 seconds. If I needed to fine tune that, I don't want to come in here and have to change that time code, right? So I have to come in here and always, you know, modify the time in seconds. By using the cue point, a lot more control. So if I move that cue point back and forth, Storyline's automatically going to read that time code anyway. Okay, so that solves the timeline part. What I want to do is, actually, let's do this real quick. I'm going to turn on my player, and I just want to add my seek bar so we can see how that pauses. So we might not show the seek bar to the learners for this, but this will just help us see that it pauses. Okay, so at this point, it's set up, but we need to now tell Storyline to fire those animations. So I'm going to preview this real quick and show you. So we won't see the animations automatically apply, but now we need to tell Storyline when to make those move, right? So we can see that I'm dropping them on here, but there's no exit animation because the timeline hasn't ended. And the way we do that is with a trigger that changes the state of the object from its normal state to a hidden state. So by changing it to a hidden state, actually the timeline of the object is going to apply, and before it'll hide, it's going to play that animation. So I'll do it for the first one to show you how that works. So we'll say change the state of, and of that drag one, note one, to, we'll say hidden. And hidden is a built-in state. It doesn't mean it deletes the object, it just means it's not visible. So we could still change it back to, you know, any other state. And we'll say when the user drops all the way at the bottom here, when the object is dropped on, when the drag one is dropped on, and the target would be either the keep or the trash. I can do both right here. So it doesn't matter which object, click OK, which object this note card is dropped on. Once it's dropped on either of those, that animation should fire. So let's take a look and see how that works. All right, so the timeline's going to pause. We should see that down here. And then I'll take my note card and drop it on the trash. And there we go. You can even play a sound effect if you want, like a fading sound. That's pretty neat, right? Now, in this case, we have these drop, correct, and incorrect states set up. You may not want that. Just because you're not really getting to appreciate that. You can't really see it as it disappears. Let me try that one more time. So maybe that doesn't make as much sense, but it just depends on how you want to set that up. So I'll put it over here, and there it is, correct. There it is, correct. And it goes away. All right, and then of course, with all animations, right, we can adjust the duration. We can choose which way, well, each animation is going to have its own options, but you can see how to make those changes here. And of course, if I want the duration to be a little bit quicker, I can do that. All right, so with that, I'm going to select the trigger we just added to that first note card. So just select it over here under Object Triggers. And let's duplicate that or copy that trigger. I'm going to copy it to the clipboard. And then I'm going to select these remaining objects so I can paste it all at once. So with those objects selected, I'm going to click the little clipboard right here and paste that trigger. And notice how this is a self-referencing trigger, which means I don't have to update the target or the object by pasting it on each of the objects. You can see Storyline recognizes that when it's drag 2 is dropped on either of those, change the drag 2 to hidden, same with drag 3 and so on. So I don't have to come in here and make those individual changes. Okay, so let's preview that. Here we go. So it won't matter which one we do. There we go. I can see I'm getting some of these correct, some of them incorrect, and so on. Now, here's just an idea for this. I really like this because this is a fun way to make things, and of course we have to submit too, right? Make things work is once all of these have been dropped on the targets and they're disappeared, we could resume the timeline. So we'd do this. We'd say trigger, and we'll say resume timeline. Resume the timeline, and on this slide, when, and we'll say the state of drag 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, when all 6 of our drag objects, when all of them are hidden, right? Because we're changing those states to hidden. So then the timeline will resume. Now, the thing I was going to say about this, though, I think in a lot of ways, maybe this works best when you only apply it to the correct choices and not the incorrects. Meaning, if you do the incorrect and it goes away, that's kind of quick. There's our resume, and then we could have this actually auto submit too. Let me show you that. But I think it might make more sense just to have these the ones that are correct go away, but then keep the incorrect choices, just so the learner has time to reflect on those and then move them back and forth. And so I mentioned the submit button. Since these are all disappearing, there isn't as clear a way to automatically submit the interaction. We still have the submit button on the player, but it might not seem as intuitive. So we could do something like having a layer or a little tooltip come up here and say, don't forget to submit. Or we could just do this automatically for the learner, right? We can have the timeline resume, and then when the timeline ends, submit the interaction for the learner. So we would just do this. We have it down here. Submit button. So submit interaction, not when user clicks, but we could say when the timeline ends, something like that on this slide, then it's going to submit and then the learner is free to move on. So that's how we could do that. And again, if you're not changing the state, if you're not having the incorrects fly out, then the timeline's not going to resume because we have that set up to only resume after all of them are submitted. So there goes my timeline, and incorrect. So an idea, a way to add a little dynamic motion to your objects, but I think it's a fun one and it's an easy one because you already have, you know, your interaction set up. You don't have to build something entirely new, but it's just a little different way to add some motion to your interactions. And there you have it, a nifty way to infuse some dynamic motion into your drag and drop interactions. Real quick before we wrap things up, I just want to leave you with a couple of parting thoughts on using the technique. First off, you might want to reserve the effect primarily for the correct choices only. Not using it with the incorrect choices means it gives learners just a better chance to reflect on why they might have made those choices or chosen incorrectly because the choice isn't disappearing right away, right? So just some food for thought. Regardless of your choice, remember that most important is the exit animations are set to trigger when that timeline reaches the end. So to ensure that your choices don't vanish all at once, just be sure to add that trigger, to pause the timeline, whether you're using it based on time or a cue point. Either way, just make sure it's there so the timeline pauses just before the end.